I am Alexandra Neal, a freshman animal science major from Las Vegas, Nevada, the vice president of the Honors Program. Greetings. Greetings and welcome to Fort Valley State University's first presidential lecture series lecture. FVSU's mission is to provide educational advancement with an emphasis upon fulfilling commitments that our community has collectively undertaken. The university is committed to embracing students' dreams for a successful future. The presidential lecture series was created by Dr. Ivar Griffith to help achieve this mission. The lecture aims to spark conversation and critical thinking, nurturing thoughtful and engaged students and communities across Middle Georgia. The series will feature speakers who present a variety of relevant topics in an effort to serve the public good through shared knowledge and insight. Our topic of discussion today, Ebola as a dynamic international disease, comes at a critical time when the world is grappling with comprehending and containing this disease. As you all may or may not know, the Ebola virus has claimed thousands of lives and has become an international concern, leaving many in fear of the disease and many unaware what the disease actually is. Today, Dr. Earl Long from the CDC will discuss the topic of Ebola as a dynamic international disease. So please, join us in this conversation as we explore and learn. At this time, I would like to welcome President Ivar Griffith.
Let's give a round of applause to Ms. Neal, wonderful Honors Program student. Thank you, Ms. Neal. We have the good fortune of celebrating this week our homecoming. And so I want to welcome you to Fort Valley's 2014 Homecoming Week. But our homecoming week also happens to coincide with the day, Friday, when the world observes United Nations Day. And we just, some of us in this room, just came from a successful third meeting of our Global Initiatives Council. And guess what? A member of that council is Dr. Earl Long. And so a few weeks ago I said, Earl, we would love to have you as part of your contribution to the work of the council, help engage in a conversation and a discussion about something that is, as Dr. Kofi Annan said, a problem without passport, Ebola. And so I'm delighted to welcome you to this inaugural Presidential Excellence Lecture and to have you engage in a conversation with Dr. Earl Long, who retired a few years from the CDC but does consulting with them as an expert, as you'll hear his bio in a few minutes. We intended our university not to begin and end the conversation about this critical issue today. We're going to be having a series of conversations with students, with members of our faculty, with the community at large. And so I want to extend an invitation now for other opportunities to which you'll be invited. Things of importance to our community, things of importance to our nation, things of importance to our world. Mine is the pleasure now, ladies and gentlemen, to introduce to you who will introduce the speaker, Dr. Kelvin Thomas. Dr. Kelvin Thomas, a microbiologist professor at Morehouse Medical School, a member of the Global Initiatives Council, will introduce our distinguished speaker. Thank you, Kelly.
Good afternoon. It's my pleasure to introduce to you Dr. Earl Long. Dr. Long got his PhD from the London School of Hygiene and Tropical Diseases. He left and went and did his postdoctoral fellowship at the University of Texas. After that, he went and joined the CDC as chief of the Laboratory for Infectious Diseases. Now, Dr. Long has a very long career of doing surveillance, particularly in the area of HIV in Africa and worldwide. He has worked with WHO, he's worked with USAID, and a number of the African countries that have been severely affected by this disease. Now, Ebola is a pretty close relative of HIV. Basically, it's an RNA virus, just like HIV. And there are lots of myths and innuendos that have been circulating about this virus lately. So you've got an opportunity to meet with an expert in infectious diseases, particularly an expert in the Ebola virus. So for the students here, I want to make sure that you get up and ask Dr. Long every single question about this virus that you've been wondering about, thinking about, and I'm quite sure he will provide you with some interesting answers to some of your questions. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce to you Dr. Earl Long.
And what I'm going to do is talk about my personal experiences working in an Ebola endemic area. Between Ebola and me, this is personal. And you'll understand a little later. So I'll give an introduction, a brief introduction to the virus, so you can see what it does. Then we'll talk about international implications. And I'll show you a series of scenes in areas where Ebola occurs, when what it does to people, and some of the factors that encourage an epidemic spread of a disease. You may have seen this. All the information that you need on the virus itself is available in vast quantities on the internet. You can Google it and see everything. But it is an unusual virus that when we think of a virus, we think of a sphere or a geometric figure. This is like a thread. And that's how it gets the name. It belongs to a family called the filoviridae. And that the name comes from the Latin filum, a thread. So that's what it looks like on an electron microscope. Its structure is very simple. It looks like a tube with a coil of DNA within it. And it's hard to believe that an organism as simple as that, without a brain, can be so effective in what it does. It was first discovered in 1976 in the DRC, during the Democratic Republic of Congo. Now, the disease was named after a river in the area. It was called the Ebola River. The years afterwards, it was discovered that this river actually was not Ebola. The river had another name, but the name Ebola was kept because it sounded good, that was all. But it was the wrong name given to the disease. And there have been 40 outbreaks since 1976 in several countries. Congo, Sudan, Gabon, Uganda, Guinea, Liberia, now Sierra Leone. And you had very limited outbreaks in Senegal, Nigeria, the USA and Spain. These were important. It's not a new disease. And some of it, just quickly, let's go over some of the symptoms. There is a early mid-stage series of symptoms, which can be very deceptive. This is why the disease is able to continue before people actually are aware of what is going on. It very closely resembles, in its symptomatology, typhoid, malaria, meningitis, gastroenteritis. It looks like the flu. So it's very difficult to diagnose. Then there's a late hemorrhagic stage with liver and kidney failure, a difficulty breathing, internal and external bleeding, reddening of the eyes, vomiting, blood, shock, and death. Now, there are some dramatic pictures which show blood coming off on very orifice. That's just some of the patients, say about 50%. And it's not blood just pouring out, it's blood just leaking slowly because the blood vessels have been destroyed. Unfortunately, this disease is transmitted by almost all body fluids. And you can see the list there, urine, saliva, sweat, feces, vomit, breast milk, and semen. And it can be found in semen 61 days after cure. The only outbreak of Ebola, this is 76, was actually transmitted via contaminated needles in that small village where there was the outbreak. Because the needles were not sterilized. Supplies were very, very limited. And it was a group of nuns in a small religious institution hospital who were using the same needles for different patients, actually were transmitting the Ebola from patient to patient. It's not spread by air or water or food. But in Africa, Ebola can be acquired by contact with some of the natural hosts. And the one that is most frequently suspected is the fruit bat or flying fox. Now, only mammals, humans, bats, monkeys, and apes have been shown to have the ability to become infected with and to spread Ebola. Now, surprisingly, Ebola is not easily transmitted. It's not as contagious as measles. There is a factor given to represent how contagious a disease is. And you can see a spectrum here from left to right. Measles has an R factor of 18. That means each case of measles has the potential to infect 18 other people. See how contagious it is. In contrast, Ebola is 2. So it's not as contagious as measles or the flu or the common cold. As a matter of fact, the most dangerous virus we have now, which is actually circulating state, is the flu. The flu kills tens of thousands of people within the United States every day. And yet there is this enormous panic all over the country because of one or two cases of Ebola. This is what is usually shown to represent what Ebola looks like. Now, if Ebola enters this through a break in the skin or cut also, or through the mucous membrane. And the mucous membranes that are most easily exposed are the conjunctiva of the eye, or the nose, or within the mouth. So the contaminant in the hand can very easily be spread simply by what you usually do to your face, touch your face. And the incubation is about 6 to 10 days. And when the Ebola gets into us, it gets to the lymph nodes, then to the spleen and that adrenal gland, that's over the kidney. Ebola does two things when it infects. It causes cells in the macrophages and stuff to release substances that cause a fever. This is why patient has a fever. Then it begins to destroy. Now what Ebola does, something very insidious. It's as if an invading army went directly for your defense forces, the police and army, wipe them out. Then the population is left without defense. So when Ebola enters the body, the macrophages, the defense cells, pick up the virus. The virus actually begins to multiply within these defense mechanisms. So after it's wiped out the immune system, it begins destroying the cells that line the blood vessels, the endothelial cells. When the blood vessels are weakened, then blood begins to leak. And it uses up all the clotting factors, so blood is not able to clot, and the blood vessels begin leaking, which is why you get the bleeding all over. Such that the patient loses an enormous amount of fluid from diarrhea. The body goes into shock because the liver breaks down, is unable to function. The heart, there is not sufficient blood to pump, the kidneys fail. So the patient dies of shock, just general organ failure. This is represents what I was telling you. The macrophage comes along at the one side, picks up the virus. The virus begins replicating within the cell and destroys it. This represents lining of the wall of the blood vessel. It infects these endothelial cells. They break down, then blood begins leaking. This is the natural host, the flying fox, fruit bat. Some years ago, I took this photograph over the training center where I was, just over the entrance. There was a tree right there. Never associated these things with Ebola. And perhaps in effect, perhaps not, but at that time, no, nobody gave any thought to this, but it's very, very common. And please do not think you can eradicate Ebola by eradicating the pests. Because the bats play a very important part in the ecology of the forests in Africa. They're responsible for pollination and distributing seeds. So this is something that cannot be touched. They are essential to the ecology. Now here are some man-made conveyors of disease. And I think you easily understand this, how an infected person can get from one place to another. Because we provide all the means for it. There are airplanes, ships, trains, cars, trucks. There are artificial borders. Remember, the borders are not marked. Animals and people do not recognize borders. So people go back and forth. Families live on different sides of the border. And what concerns me most is something that I have been involved with, and that is neglect of basic primary health care. A lot of money is invested in prestige products, beautiful hospitals, and every diagnostic capability there is, but there is nothing at the village level. Now here is the current outbreak. Liberia, Sierra Leone, Guinea. And it's thought that it actually started in Guinea, in this area. Now in January, I was asked to the health authorities asked a number of agencies to do a survey of the primary health centers in, well, the laboratories in the health centers in Guinea. And I did about half of the country. I spent about half there. And I did this part of the country, these provinces. And this is what I found. We don't have to go through in detail. But this would be a perfect score, the top lines of each one. And these are the scores I found in various institutions, down to zero. The only institution which scored very high had a total score of 58% in capability of what it could do. Only one institution in half of the country. This was what we taught the country with. And this was the team I worked with. And these were my trainees. I had about 90, not all of them were there. Remember I said this is personal? Because there were 6 students selected among the 90 who we thought would have the skills and to continue our training after I left. And shortly after I left, this lady, the owner, the only lady on the team of trainees of the 6 who were selected, and she died of Ebola shortly after. Now, when you walk through the endemic areas, these are the conditions you will see. This is a market. And you can see the conditions there are not ideal. This is a fruit market. You can see the fruit exposed. This is the butcher shop. This was one of my favorite pictures. Because the butcher was good enough to let me take a photograph, but he wanted to pose sitting in his hammock. And this is where I ate. And this is in these situations that I acquire very frequently my bouts of gastroenteritis. Because there is no refrigeration, and you have the choice of getting gastroenteritis or starving. Usually you go for the gastroenteritis. And here is something of concern, and I think some of the funding agencies are responsible for that. When HIV came, a lot of resources were poured into HIV, and the labs are very well equipped. You notice the gentleman is wearing a tie, the very well equipped lab, this is the HIV lab. You walk down the corridor, this is a microbiology lab. There's nobody there, no equipment, nothing. Because everything went into the HIV. And other basic services were neglected. Let me show you some of the hospitals where I work. This is a regional hospital. This is a health center, it goes down. From town, as you go to the village, then you end up with these little health posts. And These are typical of the laboratory conditions. Not very impressive, and sometimes not safe at all. For example, this. And this is for the most important disease now in malaria in these countries, which is malaria. Malaria is actually responsible for most of the morbidity and mortality in this endemic area. It kills thousands of children every year. And this is actually why I was asked to go to this was the primary concern, malaria, to improve our condition for diagnosing malaria. Previously, there was emphasis on treatment, but that's actually dangerous treating symptoms if you do not know what the disease is. Because sometimes you will miss a disease or you spend a lot of money treating the wrong one. So they want more accurate disease of malaria. But this, a microscope. I went into one center and asked to see the equipment, and this is what I will show. This is all they had. Or just evaluating. This actually was at a major hospital which had to take care of the first patients with Ebola. And here again, there was blood everywhere. Only found one good lab. This was the lab at the hospital which obtained the highest score. Everything was very neat. His supplies were limited, but they were neat. This is what's for malaria. You can see what malaria, this is what slides should look like. And this is what they look like. Or we had situations where healthcare workers were simply given things but not trained to use them. And these were the people that Ebola went for, the healthcare workers, the people who cared and the people who took care of others. And you see some of the laboratory practices. He's not wearing gloves, and he's putting his finger in contact with blood from a patient, which is an excellent way of spreading a disease. And this poor lady, well-intentioned, but not with bad equipment, and actually not knowing how to read a microscope. And the immediate recommendations I made were to motivate the laboratory personnel. When people are not well paid for the job, they should not be expected to give 100%. People have to live, and they need some motivation to work. So this was what I always emphasize, that people should be given adequate compensation and recognition. Okay, let's look at some of the conditions, the health facilities. This is actually quite good. It can be much worse than this. Here you have two children in a coma on one bed. These are scenes from Sierra Leone. I got it from the New York Times. With patients dying outside the hospital, on the floors of the wards, dying more quickly than they could be carried out. Now, there are a couple of factors that I want to keep in mind. Ebola does not operate independently of other factors. There are some factors which actually cause these outbreaks to happen. One of these is environmental disruption. And this is... This has implications not for one country, but for adjoining countries, for industries, for countries on other continents, because everything is interconnected. Trade is interconnected now. And with consequences for mining, damage, deforestation, global warming, and other diseases. Now, I'd like to show you some of the other diseases that are beginning to break out because of development and deforestation. Brazil, you now have spreading of Chagas disease and cutaneous leishmaniasis. People are moving, cutting down the forests, and towns are expanding. People are moving into new areas and encountering diseases. West Africa, we now have Ebola. We have Lassa, Marburg, malaria, yellow fever, all because of people moving into new environments. Southeast Asia, you remember SARS? South America, malaria. Egypt and Sudan, schistosomiasis, because of dams being expanded. So human activities actually bring people into contact with diseases. And you have outbreaks of diseases that may have been quiescent in forested areas, but now people are coming into contact with these hosts. And when you cut down the forest, the animals don't understand, they don't just move away. too, so they give you space. They stay right there or they move into your home. Deforestation. See a mountain in the back? There isn't a single tree left on that mountain. It's all gone. I don't mention names of the countries. I think it's certain. Or you burn down the forest for charcoal. Armed conflict and disease. That's another very important factor. Guinea, Sierra Leone, Liberia, Ebola and malaria. All these three countries recently suffered civil wars. So the basic public health services were destroyed. Iraq, because of the war, you now have spread of visceral leishmaniasis, or Kalaza. The Congo, because of wars again, Ebola, malaria, sleeping sickness. Sleeping sickness was something that was associated with the savannah and the forest, now it's moving into the city. Haiti, cholera, because of civil disturbances there were there. So, United Nations, the support of the United Nations, soldiers brought cholera in. But all of these things were associated with armed conflict. A conflict zone, where you have populations forced out of the villages, so they have to go into the forest for food, they acquire some of the diseases there, and bring it back. It is thought that the present outbreak of Ebola started with a 2-year-old child. In the conflict zone again, the hospitals, public health services abandoned. And all over many countries, you have landmines left behind and just abandoned military vehicles, but armaments and explosives. So this reduces farming because people are no longer able to access their farms, because of the presence of mines and other munitions left behind. Two pictures I want to show you again. This is a scene from Liberia before. This is how life was. After Ebola. Now, treatment for Ebola. There is any recognized treatment except the treatment. They just are experimental treatments. But the most important one appears to be replacing bodily fluids because of diarrhea and vomiting. And maintaining oxygen status and blood pressure. Treating other infections as if they occur. Now there are experimental vaccines and treatments for Ebola under development. But they have not yet been tested for safety or effectiveness. So. And these are some of the new drugs that are being tested. ZMAP, which is really interesting, because it is an artificial antibody, and the Australians and some of us are trying to reduce it in tobacco plants by introducing the genes into tobacco plants and causing the plants to produce these antibodies, which would be very interesting to have a plant producing a human antibody. There is an antiviral repo drug called TKM Ebola vaccine. There is now. This is being rushed in many countries now. And in Liberia, there was an anti-HIV drug, lanuvidine. Now, there was some success, but then again, it's difficult to say whether success is due to the drug that you're using or to the care that the patient is receiving. The most important factor in prevention is actually just basic hygiene. Soap and water are really very good. And not to come into contact, or if you do come into contact with the patient, the best is to avoid that contact. That's why lots of hospitals in these areas did not want visitors, not family or anything. And the last thing was very important in the Congo and also in the three recently endemic areas. And these were the burial rituals. It is very, very difficult to break traditions that are hundreds of years old. Because when a patient died, the friends and relatives wanted to touch that body. It had to be clean and washed. And everybody wanted to touch it. And the water, the fluid used for cleaning was very highly infectious. And lots of people got it that way. It was during the funeral rites. And it was very, very difficult to break these habits. Because people felt that you were cutting them away from their relatives. And from the last rites. and some of the recommendations by CDC and WHO. And I think these are pretty obvious. Avoiding contact with infected people or with wild animals. And we were told if we got ill not to go to the hospitals because these were sites of infection. One of the problems was that, which caused initially great difficulty for the authorities, because when patients were taken to the hospital, very frequently they did not return. And lots of families thought that people were being taken to the health facilities to die or to be killed. And in some areas in Guinea, in at least two cities, health workers were actually attacked and killed. And I had an incident which left me really very badly shaken. During one of my training sessions, I had gastroenteritis, and two or three people who had eaten with me at this certain restaurant all had it. Now, the training session was very intense, and some of the attendees came down with malaria. They already had it, but they had kept it in check until they were stressed. And the training program was very stressful. So some had fever, some had gastroenteritis. And somebody left the training and went to the ministry and said that my group had symptoms of Ebola, which alarmed everybody. So the ministry called and wanted to put me and everybody else in quarantine for 21 days. But by the time somebody came to check, everybody had been treated and everybody was well. But what frightened me was not somebody reporting our symptoms, but having that news get out to the community. Because the people would not have reacted well, learning that we had brought Ebola into their community, which was not a circumstance I wanted to find myself in. One of the things that happened to me was, well, it's amusing, long time after it happened, but I was stranded in Guinea for a while because Air France cancelled my flights. There were no flights, I was just stuck. So I had to work my way north, by country by country. My first stop was Mali. And I was in transit in Mali. I didn't have a visa for Mali because I was in transit. And I got to the airport on my way to Senegal, and the authorities seized my passport because I didn't have a visa. So I said, I shouldn't be here. No, you cannot be here. You don't have a visa. Okay. Well, can I get on my flight? No, you cannot get on your flight. We have to seize your passport. I said, okay, I cannot stay, but I cannot leave. Would you please explain the situation to me? And I was worried because I had no contacts. I don't have any phone connections or anything. He says, well, you're very legal. We have to hold your passport until your plane and your flight is announced, so you can come back with your passport. I said I wasn't leaving my passport. So they had police escort me out of the airport. So I sat outside for 3 hours. My plane was announced. I ran back. The office was closed. There was nobody. So I couldn't get on the airline and I couldn't stay. So I just lost it. I started kicking the door and swearing. The police came to see what was going on. And I explained to some police official what was going on. So he tried to calm me down by telling me about the good relations between their country and his. And I kept telling him, I want to leave your country. No, it's all right. We have good relations. We get along very well. But I happened to look down. And I was really angry, but I burst out laughing, which confused everybody, because he wasn't wearing socks and shoes, but he had a gun. So after a few minutes back and forth, he called somebody, and this lady came and locked into the office, went rummaging through the drawers, saw my passport. So I was able to leave. But these are the situations that nobody can prepare you for. And you really don't know what to do then, if you're in a strange country without a passport. It's not a comfortable thing. These were the signs that were everywhere in Guinea and in Conakry where I was. Now just read these out to you, these things. And this is what causes difficulty for people. Avoid all physical contact. No handshaking. It's very difficult not to do that. When you see an old friend, instinctively you do that. And it's very disturbing when you do this and somebody pulls a hand away. Do not visit any health center. And please use bleach for disinfecting, and report all cases of illness. All over the city now is the smell of bleach, because there are these containers with bleach for washing your hands. And after a while, your skin dries and begins to crack, which is another problem. This was all I carried with me, my personal protection. This comes from Target, if you want to know. Now, here is something that is not often discussed, and this is what I want to spend some time on. It is that Ebola is not just a threat to your health, it is a threat to the relationship. So it's a threat to humans and to humanity. There are travel restrictions, which have economic consequences. There are the diversion of funds for services and development. Everything now has to go to Ebola, and basic services are neglected. Then there is political and social upheaval, because people are scared, they want things done, and if they think there is a threat, they react badly. Healthcare workers were killed in several countries because people didn't appreciate that they had come to help before they had brought the disease. People were attacked and killed. The human cost, and I think this summarizes it very, very effectively. Ebola propagates itself by preying on care and love, piggybacking on the deepest, most distinctively human virtues. Affected parties are almost all medical professionals and family members caring for their fellow humans. 75% of the victims are women. Ebola parasitizes our humanity. This little girl was waiting for us in the clinic, and the expression on the face just drove me mad. That's it.
Hello, my name is Deshaun Holden. I am a junior agriculture major here at Fort Valley State University studying plant science, biotechnology, and my concern for the gentleman that gave the Ebola lecture. You've given all of the precautions and safety rules that we may take against the Ebola virus as far as sanitation and, you know, daily hygiene care. What are the chances that the Ebola virus may reach Georgia as a state or Fort Valley as a city? How concerned should we be as far as the Ebola virus reaching a city such as Fort Valley, considering that it is in long-term distance from being here?
Okay. I'll put myself in your place. I wouldn't care. I really wouldn't worry about it. Honestly. It is actually difficult for Ebola to get from there to where it is to Georgia. Because now people are so sensitized to it. The authorities are so sensitized to it that it's really difficult for a sick patient to get to Georgia. It would be difficult for the patient to get on a plane, let alone get here. I think people are necessarily worried. Now you have schools in New Jersey and I think Texas refusing entry to African students. Students from Rwanda and Nigeria are being... Somebody, I think a school official visited Zambia and went back to...
Mississippi.
Where?
Mississippi.
No, it's somewhere in the Northeast. And the school was closed. Parents took the kids out of school. All of this is unnecessary, for heaven's sakes. It's difficult to understand why people refuse to vaccinate their children but are afraid of Ebola. It's even more difficult to understand why people do not get a flu vaccine, for a disease which kills tens of thousands every year, but are afraid of a disease about 3,000 miles away. A lot of it doesn't make sense to me. I do not go to bed worrying about the ball. I'm not going to get the ball. Thank you, sir.
And also, is there any questions?
Thank you, sir.
Firstly, let me just tell you thanks so much for coming and educating us. And I am an educator, and I teach dental hygiene in Mason, Georgia. And my question for you is about fluffing. I read in one of my dental journal articles that said that non-latex gloves were more permeable than your traditional latex gloves. And then there was a big scare about allergies to latex. Everybody was going to nitrile gloves,
vinyl
gloves.
So
what's your take on that?
On what type of glove or the gloving?
Like, what type of glove do you think, in your expertise, do you think is probably the best type of glove to use in a clinical setting?
The only concern I've ever had about gloves is its sensitivity to latex. But I think all gloves are. I've never met a brand or type of club which was not effective.
Good afternoon. My name is Jackie Myers. I'm a senior mathematics major here at Fort Valley State University. Here in my hand, I have the patent for the Ebola virus. And upon doing some research, the people who are listed as the inventors are all virologists for the CDC. And the applicant for it says, the government of the United States of America is represented by the Secretary Department of Health and Human Services. So my question is if this virus has been around for about 40 years or so, why is it just now being patented in about 2007? And what is the purpose of the patent? Because from my experience, my knowledge, you put a patent on something to preserve the intellectual property on something. When you seek to make some type of profit off of it. So, my question is, what is the purpose of the patent?
Honestly, I can't answer that because this is new to me.
Okay.
I don't know anything about patenting.
Hello, you have a staff which graduated about contagious Ebola is, and it's sort of on the lower end in terms of its ability to be transmitted from person to person, of course, direct contact. And of course, with Ebola, the fear level is very high for this particular virus. Because imagine there have been movies made about it, well, loosely related to how Ebola may be transmitted. But one of the questions I'd like to get your take on how the virus was transmitted to those healthcare workers at Presbyterian Hospital in Dallas. So what's your take on how the virus is able to be transmitted? So these are the things like those?
No, I don't want to know. Anything I say would be speculative.
Okay.
I really want I learned one possible explanation that some of the liquid got on some of these guys. I heard some liquid patient was deposited on the neck. And after maybe the finger may have brushed against it. So, because in these cases there was not total water protection. I think there was the face to read, but this part of the body was exposed. So there is a potential, but no water.
Right, so the virus can be transmitted from, and then the skin represents a pretty...
Not from the skin, yes, on the skin, but could have been transmitted from that spot to... I mean, it's just the mouth goes up.
Thanks.
It's very easy to brush your hands and then brush your eyes. And that was awesome. But that is effective, nobody knows exactly.
CNN stated yesterday that a patient in the U.S. was released from the hospital and cured of Ebola. So why is the government saying that it's no cure?
There isn't any treatment. The patient self-cure. Because mortality and without any treatment varies from about 90%. Not everybody who gets Ebola dies. Even with no treatment, some people recover. And right now, in the current outbreak, it's about 60% of people survive. That's what I meant by that cure. It's self-cure. It's not cure from treatment.
My question question about those people who have been treated and have such deep Ebola free. Must be about 100, 200 people by now. Especially those three or four intense cases they've cured and left back into the population. Is there, what chance, or is there any chance that those people who have been treated and declared Ebola free will have recidivism or recurring them in any gene cycle?
Oh, we don't know yet, and so far, there have never been any instances of that. Because Ebola has been around for, well, this is 40 years ago. But, yeah, and there have been outbreaks since, but there have been no reports of somebody who's cured having a recurrence of the disease. Now, this doesn't say that this isn't going to happen. We don't know. But so far, no. Not yet.
Hi. My question is in regards to like experimental treatment. You said that the virus is closely related to the HIV/AIDS virus, correct?
No, not
closely related.
It's a different family.
It's in a different family?
Yes.
Okay, now I have a question.
Good afternoon, sir. Ask a basic question on is virus a living thing? And is there any other different strains of virus, like Ebola virus, that has been detected? Like HIV has different strains. And,
yes.
And one other question is, does the virus, isn't it redundant that the virus needs a host to live? Is the once it gets into the host, it actually destroys the host. So what's the purpose of the virus, or is it depending on what it will be contacted by somebody else to jump, but it's not a living thing, that's why I asked.
These are really very interesting questions, and this is the first one they asked, and something that I think about all the time. When I first read about viruses, you said viruses are not living. But they are so effective in what they do that it's hard to believe that this is not living. But the virus is a pretty good parasite, because it doesn't carry everything it needs. What it does is simply gets a host to do it for it. Everything else for it. But it is extremely efficient in what it does. So it's difficult to say that it's not living. But it doesn't do the other things that other living things do. So it's right in the middle there. With reference to the other question that you posed, why does it destroy the host? Well, it's not the starting host. And it's not the host of the food factor. They live together quite well enough, because the virus wants to maintain its host, so it doesn't kill it. The problem is when you take it out of its host and put it into an unnatural host, the host doesn't have any protection. The virus goes crazy. It's like anthrax. Anthrax destroys everything completely. But what it does is simply wait for the next one. Answer your question. But these are very, very interesting questions. Things that keep you awake at night.
Hello, Dr. Earl. Thank you for your excellent presentation. My question is, how long can Ebola virus can survive? My question is, the nurse from Dallas, she went to Cleveland, Ohio, then came back to Dallas again. During that period, any virus, even any places can infect, and there is some period when next year somebody can be infected, any touch, any from the visitor, the any places she infected with the virus, and somebody else can get the virus from their situation.
Can somebody carry for a long time?
Yes, the nurse infected the Ebola virus, and she came from Cleveland, Ohio to Dallas. During that period, the virus can be spread. Is it a possibility that somebody else can get, maybe next year, somebody can get the virus from that distance, any implantation, move it up?
After 1 year?
After 1 year?
No, because the incubation period is 21 days, that's the maximum.
So the virus cannot survive after 21 days?
No, it's just in the environment, on the surface also, in just a few hours.
or I'm sorry that they no, just a few answers, some drivers cannot survive.
No,
it can't survive desiccation dry. Like if I put a drop of blood on the table, after about 6 hours the virus will be dead. It has to be kept moist.
Sort of piggyback off of the question on that. With there being a virus and Texas host and here spreading, should we allow for it to take its course? This is just a virus. Like, should we intervene?
Or are you suggesting just let the patient?
Yeah, like in Africa, yeah, in Africa or the origin where it began, should we just let it go, play out, and let it play out?
I don't quite understand. Or just to leave things as they are?
Yeah.
So it dries up?
Because there is a possibility that the blood that is being infected doesn't kill the host.
Oh.
No.
See, what you have then is a reservoir for reinfection of other people.
That's right.
And not everybody survives, let's say 50%, but you still have this potential for infecting 50% of the people who come into contact with it.
That's true.
We're just happy that the final question.
Yes, sir. My question was, is there anything that we can learn from the fruit bat on how, I guess, we can adapt or make experimental medication to treat Ebola or to actually live with it like the fruit bat does? Is there anything that we can gain?
No, this is an evolutionary process.
Okay.
Yeah. Right.
Okay.
What would like to happen is for generations, maybe hundreds of years, of constant infection. After a while, all the susceptible people die, and the resistant ones continue. But you know, this is something that evolution takes care of. This is not anything human should even think about. This is actually what we do with vaccinations, because that's what the vaccine does. It gives you a weakened dose of a pathogen. So you actually are infected, but what's put into you does not cause the infection. It just stimulates your own resistance. So when the real thing comes along, you're resistant to it. This is what you do with vaccination.
Dr. Al, is it correct to say that we have two strains of Ebola? If you say yes, could you kindly say a few things about the second strain?
No, I don't have much expertise, but there were more than two. And they named half the places. The one in Guinea now is called Ebola Zaire, because that's where it was exactly in the Congo. But there's Ebola Sudan, Ebola Uganda, Ebola. They lived off the places they got in the Congo.
Because they all have the same lethal effect.
More or less, not exactly. There are some with 90% lethality and others with 50.
Thank you.
Would resuscitation be safe at this point if we were to have someone to go into a rest on campus? Or what would you suggest as the
resuscitation, like mouth to mouth?
Yes, sir.
Oh, no.
No, so the question is, how would we go about this?
Well,
getting them.
Yeah, well, just. You call it emergency medical services.
Hi, Dr. Long. Thank you for the presentation of Dr. Shakespeare, faculty in biology at the biology department here. And my question, similar to the question the gentleman before me was asking, in regards to the virus's ability to mutate, what are your thoughts about vaccine development? How likely is that?
Oh, it's more than likely. It's going full blast now in several places.
Even with the multiple strands and, yes. And this virus's capacity to mutate, that's been one of the big issues with HIV vaccines.
Right.
It's the issue of mutation and to have multiple strands. So
yes.
I just wonder about the effectiveness.
Well, I think nobody knows about the effectiveness. This is just starting. But I think the potential is better for Ebola because people who have recovered from Ebola are resistant.
Okay.
but the HIV nobody actually becomes resistant. So I think the potential is greater. And you know, this is ongoing in several places, in Asia, Europe, and the Americas, on the vaccine production. But we won't know anything for so several months. But this is going full blast now.
Thank you.
On behalf of the students, we would like to thank Dr. Lam for your presentation and for educating us about Ebola, because some of us may think that it's an African thing. However, now it's global. Because if I could I'd be able to move from Africa to US and move from US to anyone. So we would like to thank you for your time, the education, and the experiences you shared with us. And I hope everybody will take a thought from it, and then we'll use it to educate those who are not here and know about the disease. Thank you.
Let's give a round of applause to Ms. Erica Clark. We're going to be done in a minute, but let me just say two quick things. Thank you, Eric. I'd like to invite Dr. Long to wind his way on the outside. I'm sure that each of us here will be educated even if only for one additional factor. And I'm hoping that we have more than one factor that we're educated about. And I think it's important for us to recognize not only the value added we will have gained about the public health and medical implications of it, but look at the economic, look at the political. Look at the fear factor, the social aspect. And I'm sure that by the time we will have had a chance to go beyond what we've learned here, maybe take one of those handouts if you get on the outside, find a way to follow the conversation, devoid of the panic and the fear, but looking to the science and the rationality. This would have been a wonderful opportunity for us to elevate what we know about this problem with our task force, thanks to Dr. Earl Long. So let's give Dr. Long.
I also want to thank the co-sponsors, House and Healthcare. I want to thank them for the support.
I want to thank the Department of Biology, the Undergraduate Research Program, Honors Program. Very many people in external affairs were part of this, very many people in the honors program. Let's give a round of applause. Very happy to be here. Lots of hard work we've done by our marketing communications during this week, and there's a lot of homecoming events. So I want to thank marketing and communications and the IT team. This is being streamed not only in campus, but outside of our university. And the work of the IT team deserves a special commendation for the work of the colleagues. Now, generally when universities have distinguished speakers like Dr. Marlon, we're able to give him a check. But we don't have a check for Dr. Marlon. We have an esteemed colleague, member of our Global Initiatives Council, who is giving this educational value added as part of his service to our university. He deserves another outstanding round of applause.
Well, we have the two tokens of our appreciation. I'll come around.
This could have been we do have a study on Ebola on campus. I have some students collecting data on Ebola, and I just wanted to make that announcement that the study started before the talk, and I would like to have people think that we are getting us off the seminar. But I would appreciate all the information. We've collected about 300 students has filled out some questionnaires about Ebola, and we're going to do a paper on Ebola. And we are so happy that you was here to give us this talk. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. So, from our token of appreciation to Dr. Earl Long in recognition for excellence in global engagement,
Fort Valley State University Global Initiatives Council 2014. We also want to give you Earl this poster.
I can show
this to my friends. I can show them a check. Thank you very much. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, the distinguished lecture is over. Thank you.